I need a show of hands to start off this morning. How many of you have ever seen the 1990s Christmas movie Home Alone? Raise your hand. You just watched it. Yeah, it's a good movie. I figured there was going to be several of you raising your hands this morning. This is a classic, right? A little boy named Kevin, I believe that's his name, if I remember right, pictured there on the front. He and his family decide to take a Christmas trip as a family, right? They decide to go off somewhere. Well, the morning of, what happened? They woke up late, and they had to rush to pack everything. They ran into the car, rushed out the door. They got to the airport, ran to the terminal, got on the plane, and the plane took off. And in their haste, what happened? They forgot Kevin back at the house. Unfortunately, they didn't realize he was missing until partway through their flight, and uh-oh, Kevin's missing. Back at home, what's Kevin doing? He woke up and realized everyone's gone. And like a little kid, he took advantage of being home alone. He watched TV, ate whatever he wanted to eat, he did whatever he wanted to do. For a little bit, Kevin enjoyed being home alone. Now, while that was happening with Kevin and his family, a string of robberies were happening in the neighborhood. Two men, you can see them pictured in the background there, they were robbing homes of families they knew were gone on vacation. They thought Kevin and his family were gone. They thought the home was wide open to be robbed. And they came to the house and realized something's going on. They saw a lot of commotion. And so they decided not to rob the house, but instead watch and see what's going on. After a little bit of observing, they realized Kevin was home alone. Thinking they could handle a little kid, these robbers decided to come back one night, and Kevin overheard when they were planning on coming, when they were planning on robbing the house, and he was determined to be ready. He was determined to not let these robbers take anything from his home. I'm actually going to show you a two-minute video clip. I know we don't usually do that in church, but I'm going to show you a two-minute video clip of the things that Kevin did in order to be ready for these robbers, and take note of everything he does, because he doesn't just do one, two, three things. He doesn't haphazardly do anything. He has everything very meticulously mapped out of what he's going to do, okay? The first 15 seconds, by the way, take place in a church. Ignore that part. Don't ignore church, obviously, but ignore that part of the video clip, and then take note of what Kevin does to be ready. Here we go. We're going to pause it, and maybe there'll be sound in a second. There we go.
What about you?
Me?
Yeah, you and your son.
We'll see what happens. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Did you notice all the little things that Kevin did to be ready? He didn't just haphazardly do things. You saw at the beginning of that clip, he cleared his desk, rolled out a blueprint with every little thing he needed to do to be ready. He booby-trapped every door and window, right? He even put that hot iron on the door handle so when somebody grabbed it, burn them. He iced the staircases. He put tar and nails sticking straight up on the basement stairs. He did everything he could to be ready for these robbers. And by the show of hands, you all know he was ready, right? Kevin was ready for those robbers to come and rob his home. Are you ready? Not for robbers to come to your home, but are you ready for Jesus to come back on the last day? This morning we'll look at Luke chapter 12 to see what it means to be ready. If you'd like to follow along, we'll be going through those verses now, and we'll start with verses 35 to 36. Jesus is speaking. He says, "Be dressed, ready for service, and keep your lamps burning, like servants waiting for their master to return from a wedding banquet, so that when he comes and knocks, they can immediately open the door for him." So back in Jesus' day, weddings were not like they are today. Things were not scheduled out verbatim like they are today. Like, you know, the bride and groom get their picture taken here at this moment, and then they go here, and then their toast, and then their first kiss, and their first dance, and it's all scheduled out. It was not like that in Jesus' day. In Jesus' day, the groom would actually go to the bride's father's home and pick up his bride. And he would bring her back to his home. And it wasn't scheduled. He could come back at any moment. Now, I know this is talking about a master returning from a wedding banquet, but think about the wedding itself. That groom could go back to his home at any moment, and so the bridal party waiting at the home had to be ready at all times. They had to be waiting and watching. They had to be dressed and ready to celebrate. Jesus uses that picture of a wedding as a whole to point out to Christians back then and to Christians like you today of what it means to be ready. Be dressed and ready. Don't be caught with your pants down by your ankles. Don't be caught unshowered without your teeth brushed. Be ready. Now, what does Jesus mean by be dressed and ready? Well, if you'd read the rest of God's Word, you'd find out that being ready means being in the Word. You come to church. You attend Bible classes. You have home devotion and prayer life. You gather together with fellow Christians. You're in the Word. Why? Because when you're in the Word, God makes your heart ready. He strengthens your faith to believe in Jesus as your Savior when you are in the Word. That's what it means to be dressed and ready. And then Jesus also says, keep your lamps burning. Those servants that had to wait for their master or the bridal party that waited for the groom and bride to return, they didn't know when they were returning. They had to be in a constant state of readiness. They had to have lamps burning because they could return at 2 a.m., 3 a.m., 4 a.m., pitch black. They had to, the master and the groom and the bride had to be able to see where they were going. They had to have lamps burning. Your lamps are your lives of faith. Your lamps is that light that you reflect the greatest light in your life, Jesus. When people in the dark world around you, the darkness of sin, the people who don't know Jesus, when they see you, they are to see light, they're to see hope. They are to see Jesus through you in your words and in your actions, the loving actions, the kind words, the helpful, everything you do is to be a light in the dark world around you. Are you ready? Are you dressed and ready with lamps burning? Verse 37, Jesus says, "It will be good for those servants whose master finds them watching when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will dress himself to serve, will have them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them." Now the word good here is a good word. It's a good translation, but it's not the best translation of that word in the Greek. This word in the original language is actually the word blessed. It will be a blessed day. Those servants will be blessed who are ready, who are watching, who are waiting for their master, who are waiting for the bride and groom. They will be blessed on the last day. Because when the master, Jesus, returns, he's going to turn the tables. The greatest servant of all is not going to be served, but he's going to continue to serve. Believers in Jesus are going to be welcomed to that great marriage feast, that wedding banquet in heaven, and they're going to sit at the table. They are going to be blessed. They are going to be served, beloved by God for eternity. Are you ready for that? The last couple of verses. "It will be good for those servants whose master finds them ready, even if he comes in the middle of the night or toward daybreak. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him." You saw in the video clip about how Kevin was ready. He had done everything imaginable to be ready for those robbers. But he knew. He knew when they were coming. He knew the time and the day when they were going to try and rob his home. So he could be ready exactly on time. You can't. In our second reading, we heard Jesus say, "I am coming soon." And ever since those words had been spoken, there have been countless predictions of the last day, haven't there? People have predicted the end of the world time and time again, but what's happened? We're here. We're still here. Those days have come and gone. You can't predict the last day. It's going to come at an hour when you don't expect. You can't be ready for the exact hour because you don't know the exact hour Jesus is coming back. And he's not coming back as a robber to rob your home. He's coming back as your great and glorious Savior to take you to be with him forever in the glories of heaven. He's coming back to love you, to serve you. You are going to be blessed for eternity when he returns. Are you ready? Are you ready for that last day? I'm guessing you've all taken a trip. It's easy for me to assume you've all had a trip somewhere. You've packed a duffel bag. You've gone in your car. You've gone in an airplane before. Have you ever had to run back inside your home because you realized you forgot something? Or if you were only a few minutes away from your house, you had to turn around and come back? Or maybe you were halfway to your destination. It was just too far to turn back to go home to get what you forgot, and you stopped at a store to buy what you forgot. Moment of truth, I can't remember ever going on a trip where I didn't forget something. I mean, I've forgotten belts for a wedding, which then the bride gets really mad at you. I've forgotten spices on a camping trip, and then my burgers tasted really, really bland. I forgot my cell phone charger. I forget things, and I'm sure you have too, right? You don't always remember what you need. You're not always as ready as you want to be or should be for your trip. Unfortunately, that's the same for when it comes to being ready for the last day. You're not always as ready as you should be. Get tired of being 100% ready for the last day. Year after year, however long you've been a Christian, however long you've been connected to church, you've heard that message, I'm coming soon, be ready, right? You've heard that more than once. He hasn't come yet. For two millennia, Christians have heard that same message. He hasn't come yet. You get tired of being ready, of being as ready as you can be, of doing everything you can do. You get lazy. You skip church. I can go another week, he'll come later. If he hasn't come yet, he's probably not coming this week. Come up with excuses to not go to Bible class. Your to-do list is so long that something needs to be cut from your to-do list that day. And so, devotion and prayer, that's an easy thing to throw out the window because, I can do that tomorrow. I can do that any day. You don't do it. You make excuses, make up reasons, make up lies to not gather with fellow Christians because you know there your faith will be strengthened, but you don't go for that. You go because you don't want to go. Or you don't go because you don't want to go. Get tired of waiting for the last day. Get tired of being as ready as we can be. And on top of being tired, we get distracted, don't we? A couple examples. You come to church. You come with every intention of focusing and paying attention to God's Word, of making sure you're ready for the last day. Oh, what are they doing over there? I'm not trying to look at any of you specifically, by the way. Just, what are they doing over there? Oh, I wonder what they're thinking. They don't look great today. You get distracted by what people are doing. Rather than focusing on what actually matters is being ready for the last day. Or maybe it's not people, maybe it's things. You come to church and, that's interesting. That's new. That's the bad word of change. I don't like that. You get distracted with material things that don't actually matter. You wonder, did they hear that? I hope they heard that. Rather than, was that for me? We get distracted not even just at church, but out in society. If I took a poll, and I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand for this, but how many of you had anxiety this last week about something? Or within the last month? I'd probably call you a liar if you didn't raise your hand. And what do we do when we have those anxious moments? We don't go to God's Word. We don't go to the Word where God makes our hearts ready and able to get through those things. We go to ourselves. We go to society. We go to other people. We're not always as ready as we should be. We're not doing everything we can to be ready. We get tired. We get distracted. And that turns into disinterest. If I was to tell you that tonight at 10 o'clock, your home would be broken into, you would set every home alarm system you had, you would turn on every light inside and outside your house, and you would probably have the police on standby, and maybe you would even be ready to protect it yourself. If you'd be that ready to protect possessions that don't actually matter, why are you not always as ready as you should be for the last day, the day eternity is at stake? Jesus said it will be good for that person who's ready. Which means you can very properly conclude it will be bad for those who are not. And if you go the opposite of blessed, it's cursed. It'll be a cursed day for those who are not ready, who are not in the Word, who don't follow what Jesus says. And if we're in one of those tired moments or those distracted moments or just disinterested moments, that'll be us. It would be our fault for not being ready. But you know, the thing about your readiness, it doesn't depend on you. You don't make you ready. I know that's probably really bad English, but you don't make you ready for the last day. God makes you ready. He makes your heart ready for the last day. As you come to church and listen to God's word, as you sing it in song, as you read the words, as you listen to the Bible read, He strengthens your faith. He makes you ready for the last day. As you come to Bible class and dive in even deeper into God's word, He strengthens your faith even more. When you have daily devotions and prayer, He strengthens your faith even more. He makes you ready for the last day. When you gather with fellow Christians and encourage each other with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, like the book of Colossians talks about, He makes you ready. He makes you ready when you're in the Word. And then He makes you ready in the sacraments. When you were baptized, the Holy Spirit created faith in your heart. You were in the darkness, and He created light inside of you. He created faith. Faith that believes in Jesus as your Savior from sin. Faith that knows He lived, died, and rose for you, forgiving you of everything you've ever done wrong. And then, if you come up to the Lord's table and you take and eat for the forgiveness of your sins, you take and drink, you are literally receiving God's forgiveness right then and there. He is strengthening your faith in the sacrament. He's strengthening your faith to be ready for the last day. Through word and sacrament, God makes you ready. And so, are you ready? Yes. You are ready for the last day. Because by faith alone in Jesus, He makes your heart ready. But He hasn't come yet, has He? We're still here. So what are some things you can do? What is your blueprint that you can roll out onto a desk and say, these are the things I need to do to be ready? And remember, it's not you doing them. It's not you making you ready. It's God making you ready. But it's good to do those things because God works through the Word and He works through sacrament. There's three things. First, you're ready in the Word. You put church on your calendar. I don't want to ask who does that, but do you have church on your calendar? So you know if someone asks you, what are you doing on Sunday morning, you can say, I'm booked. I've got something going on. You put it on your calendar because it's a priority in your life because you know that at church, your faith is going to be strengthened. You don't make up excuses to not come to Bible class. Instead, Bible class is your excuse to not do anything else. That long to-do list that you have, devotion and prayer life are on top, and if that takes all day and nothing else gets done, great. When people invite you to gather together with fellow Christians, like at Advent by candlelight, or as you'll listen to later about a Christmas movie night at church, you go. Because you know your faith is going to be strengthened. There you know God is going to make you ready for the last day even more than you already were. So you're ready in the Word. You're ready with lamps to serve. Did you notice that word serve or the word servant or just the idea of servant and master in the text earlier? I kind of glossed over it intentionally. Those lamps, your lives of faith, are to be used to serve others. You live your life to serve that person, to love them, to help those people over there. Your life is one that is dedicated for service to God and to others, and that's how you set out in your life. And then it goes with this one, but the third one is ready with lamps of faith. If you can see in the picture, it's pretty dark down by a person, really down in the middle there. but above is light. There's darkness all around you. You live in a dark world, which means you live in a place where people don't know Jesus. Your lives of faith are those lights. You are a light shining in a dark place, and when you live your life of faith, people see that. Through your words and through your actions, may they be loving, never pushing someone down. May they be supportive and always helpful, even if you don't always like what they're doing. Your lives of faith are to reflect the greatest light of the greatest servant there ever was, that was your Savior Jesus. So your blueprint for being ready for the last day, to do everything you can like Kevin, has these three things and probably, hopefully more, is you're ready in the Word with lamps to serve and lamps of faith. So you saw in the movie how, or in the video clip, how Kevin was ready. He did everything he could, right? Kevin's readiness resulted in good things happening. If you've seen the movie, and most of you have, you know that the robbers didn't take anything, and in fact, they were actually arrested by the police. Kevin cleaned everything up, his family came home, and they celebrated Christmas together. Good things happened because Kevin was ready. Second half of verse 37, one more time. Truly I tell you, he will dress himself to serve, will have them recline at the table, and will come and wait on them. Are you ready? Because on the last day, your Savior Jesus is going to come back, and he's going to serve you. He's going to welcome you to that banquet table, that heavenly feast. And there you are going to be served by God. You're going to be loved by God for eternity. All because you believed in Jesus. But remember, it's not you who made you ready, it's God. He made your heart ready through word and sacrament. And how do you know that's what's going to happen? How do you know that on the last day you will be ready because God made you ready? Jesus said the words, truly I tell you, that's his stamp of this is going to happen, and you don't need to doubt it. There's hope of eternal life because of what Jesus did for you. So are you ready? Yes, you are. By God's grace, you are ready for the last day because Jesus makes you ready. Amen.